सुबह के 6 बजे से काम शुरू करते हैं और रात के 10 बज जाते हैं।
कुछ कुछ सवारियाँ ऐसी होती है, चलो ये सुन के ना बंदे का दिल टूट जाता है।
सेविंग हो तो फिर सपने देखने का मजा है।
ऑटो ड्राइवर्स who had never even seen a smartphone are going through a complete lifestyle makeover. They now make e-wallet transactions, have become technologically aware. Another major shift is that the drivers are not just being booked for rides, but also for deliveries. This broadens their horizons nonetheless, but also reduces their idle time.
15 से 20 राइड हो जाती है डेली की, जिससे हमारी इनकम बढ़ गई है।
तो बार्गेनिंग करनी पड़ती है, सवारी ढूंढनी पड़ती है, उन सब से छुटकारा मिल चुका है।
In other industries, we've had an impact too.
We have the Indian team that took an app in Rex Cargo for almost a year now.
Deliver smiles to thousands of customers.
Tukan has helped us in relaying our information, simple, quick and easy to use.
From a small room, we have shifted to a big office.
It saves time and money on training new members.
The impact that we have put on the 200 to 300 people registered on our platform, that really keeps our spirits high and keeps us growing.
Touching billion lives, one bit at a time.
Hello everyone. My name is Samar, and I am the CEO and founder of a company called Jugnoo. We run in India, and we are an on-demand hyperlocal marketplace. So for those of you who don't know what that is, we basically provide, you connect buyers and sellers in a small radius, so typically about 5 kilometers. And the way we define our company is that we are focused on tier 2 cities in India, which is like smaller cities of India, and typically about 1 million population roughly, and we do about 50,000 transactions every day. And in this talk, I want to talk about how on-demand technology can change local communities, especially in developing countries, because you know, so to give you a story, so when I was in Tokyo, the first thing that comes to mind is, can our technology work here? So, but we see that there's so much infrastructure, almost any time of the day you want anything, it's available. The reason for that is the infrastructure is great. But if you go to the place I come from, it's not possible. So people don't have the same infrastructure and possibilities available to them. And we think that maybe technology can help us leapfrog the infrastructure needed and use that technology to provide the same level of convenience to people in developing countries. So I'll tell you a little bit about that. By the way, this picture is from a place very near to where we live. And this is the kind of lifestyle people have. I can't, yeah. So first of all, I would like to talk about why on-demand is actually, why do we think that on-demand technology can change the way people think in developing countries and way people live in developing countries? The first thing is technology. Technology was never so cheap. Today, you can have a $100 smartphone in every pocket, and it can pretty much do almost all commerce that you want to do. So if you go to India, you know, its smartphone penetration is growing really fast. It's the biggest smartphone market in the world today. And people finally have a context-aware device in their hands all the time. The second thing is lifestyle, which means that the way people are used to consuming products and services is changing fundamentally. What I mean by that is, like earlier, people used to plan things in advance. Today, people want everything right away. Nobody wants to plan anything. People just, you know, want something, they want it right away. And also, the transactional nature of things has changed. So people don't really want commitment. So because of these trends in change of consumption patterns, on-demand is actually getting more and more important. And finally, on the supply side of things, so the crowd is there, which I, you know, what I mean by that is that today, when somebody thinks of doing a job, they are comfortable of not having a contract for a year or 2 years and are still okay to work for a company. So, you know, I know a person in San Francisco who does deliveries in the afternoons and then does, you know, drives Uber in the night and finally plays as a musician in freelance gigs. So pretty much all of his life is pure freelance. So he can choose, you know, of what to do and not. And that happens real time. He does not really have a schedule. He doesn't really have a plan for any day. Job comes to him. He accepts or rejects based on his time, based on his mood, or, you know, whatever priorities he has. So basically, that is one of the fundamental change in the shift of mindset of people, how they want to work. And so these are the trends that are actually propelling on-demand and making it powerful. And I'll give you a little bit of, you know, how much on-demand has changed, you know, for people. So this is a research done by Intuit, which is a, you know, accounting company. And they've seen that 70% of people who work in on-demand industry are satisfied. And the biggest reason is actually the flexibility. Now they can work when they want to work and how they want to work. They can switch jobs in a matter of hours, not days, not let alone months. And most people are actually working with different companies at the same time. So sort of commitment has given way to flexibility, and things are very, very fluid. You know, today I want to work, I'll work. But today, you know, I don't feel like working, I'll not work. Only a few percentage, you know, 11% in this case, are working in on-demand companies because they can't find a permanent job, right? It's a very small percentage if you look at it. And at the same time, even those people in the beginning start in on-demand as a way to augment their income or because they don't have a permanent job, but eventually move on to like on-demand more than a regular paying job. So this is, you know, the impact that on-demand is having on the world. And then, you know, a little bit about what impact did we have as Jugnoo. So Jugnoo works for a very different strata in India. So tier two cities in India, our customers are mostly middle to lower income group people in India. And our drivers or supply side is mostly low income group. So their average income used to be about, you know, a little less than $200 when they started with us. And today, we started about 2.5 years ago. In these 2.5 years, we have been able to get their income increased by about 40% on an average, right? Which is basically the biggest metric we track. And then we have had 20,000 people in India who have become income taxpayers for the first time in their life. Over 30,000 people have opened bank accounts for the first time because of our company. So these people have not been, you know, part of mainstream economy at all, and they have been put into mainstream economy by us. So that's the kind of impact we have had on Indian economy in the last 2.5 years. So now what we want to do is, we basically want to take this impact and make it global, which is why I'm here, to understand how this technology that we have built can actually go beyond India and help even small businesses, you know, flourish. So this is the stack, the way we look at. The bottom platform is called Toucan, and then there is Jugnoo and Juggernaut, which are the offerings that sit on it. I'll explain a little more. So basically what it means is that Toucan is a platform which is a technology platform. Everything is built on top of it. There are components in Toucan, which I'll explain in the next slide. And then Juggernaut is basically the modules that go on top of Toucan. So for example, if you want to want to build a billing, you can want to connect token with a billing software, you will want a custom module that is called Juggernaut. And finally, Jugnoo is basically the full stack service that uses these two things as the technology backend, but actually provides end-to-end solution. So you know, you want a, you know, ice cream, it'll actually give and come and give to you. And so in token, these are the things that we need, right? So basically what it means is that any on-demand company or any business that wants to go on-demand typically would need these eight things as their basic technology infrastructure. We think it's a new type of software. We call it field force management software. And these are the basic components of that. So the first component is aggregation, right? So what it means is you are taking people and putting them on the platform. You just take their details, and they are available on demand. So they have a smartphone application. And through that smartphone application, they can accept or request or reject jobs at any given time in real time. And then there is a piece called scheduling. So anybody knows that this is the time frame where I want to work and not. So this is more like a workflow schedule management, but in real time and context aware. By context awareness, it means that not every person can be open for any type of job at a given time. A person can be doing different types of jobs at different times. So that has to be known to this component. And thirdly, there is profiling, which means that so when you want to have a platform, right, which is doing real-time transactions, you want to make sure that people on that platform are credible and reliable. You don't want somebody to be cheating. You don't want somebody to be rude to the customer and stuff like that. So what you do is you basically build a profile based on the history of the service providers. And this profile gets better with time. And in the beginning, the data is seeded from, you know, databases like social security numbers and things like that. But eventually, based upon the kind of work you are doing, this keeps getting better and better. And fourth component is matching. So this is actually, I would say, the most critical piece of this whole platform. What it does is that when a customer requests a transaction, that could be that, OK, my you know, wash basin is not working. I want a plumber. So the matching component would find the right fit for that transaction. It could be based upon time. It could be based upon distance, it could be based upon skill set. So these three parameters, it will take as an input and give you a result in real time, typically in less than 30 seconds, and match the consumer to the service provider. So if you think about e-commerce, right, it's the inverse of it. The way e-commerce works is that you know the resources beforehand, all your inventory is cataloged, and then the customer requests it, and everything is predetermined, right, based upon the customer's location. But in this case, everything happens once the transaction has been requested. So everything is real time. So typically, it's like a bottom-up approach to doing mobile commerce. That's why it's so fundamentally different from e-commerce. And the fifth component is notifications. Of course, you need to make sure that people are, you know, updated, but at the same time, not annoyed. So you need to be having an intelligent notification system. And the next component is tracking. So in tracking, a few components, few things to kind of look for are, it should be the battery consumption should be really low. That's the most important piece. And privacy concerns have to be figured out. So in some cases, it's OK to track service provider real time. But in some cases, it's not. So you have to be very, very transparent to the service providers and the customers. What is being tracked? How is that information being used? And how are you going to, you know, basically use that information to make your system intelligent and do more transactions per unit time. And then there is payment. So payments is one module that is fairly unique for every place. So for example, you know, some places people like to use credit cards and debit cards. Some places people like to use use cash. In India, it's predominantly cash, but now shifting to digital very, very fast. So this is typically built according to the geographical location of the you know, the system which that country typically follows. And finally, there is curation. So what it means is, once a transaction happens, you need to make sure that the feedback is noted down, and this, based on this feedback, there are people who actually change their behaviors. So if a customer is doing certain kind of transactions again and again, we need to learn that and make those transactions easier. On the supply side, if a customer and supplier are working with them again and again, we want to make sure they get matched so that there's a better level of comfort. So these are the things that we have built and as a platform. So what we are doing now is, we have taken this platform and built it in a way that companies across the world, which are small on-demand companies, they could be small restaurants wanting to take their business online, or these could be small startups who are basically on-demand startups. They are using this product to build and start their companies fast. The technology that we have already built is basically helping people to build their companies from the ground up and not having to build everything from the scratch. That's the idea of our latest initiative. And finally, it's, you know, I'll tell you a little bit about the thesis behind the whole concept. The thesis is that, you know, there's a huge risk of one company controlling everything, right, in the on-demand world. So we believe that if we can actually empower smaller companies with the same technology that, you know, really huge companies like Uber have, we can actually hopefully build a much better ecosystem that is much more economically well divided. So that's pretty much it. Thank you very much. I'll be there for questions and answers if you're interested. Thanks a lot, guys.